you welcome this morning. Tonight's hot August day. We're getting closer and closer to September. Amen.
Right?
We all need September to come. We're glad that you could meet with us today for our praise and worship. We have some who are not among us today. We need to pray for Kenny and Shannon. They have gone to Florida this week because their sister-in-law had passed away. But on the way back, they had car trouble. And they were hoping to get everything towed and repaired this morning before being able to come back home. So pray that they actually had to stay in their car because they were having some type of alternator problem issue, and they couldn't, if they locked the doors were unlocked. So they had to sleep in their car and then hopefully get it towed this morning. So we're thankful that they survived the night. We pray that they have they survived the rest of the trip back, and that they're able to get their car fixed. We have others who are not with us due to family things and having to go out of town. But you're here. We are here. And we're here to praise the Lord. Our choir is going to be a little different this morning. A little different, not too different, but a little different. We're called the Trinity Choir. Don't ask which one's the Father, which one's the Son, and which is the Holy Ghost. We're not going to go that direction. But we're going to try to do the best to leave the music. You have it there in your bulletin. And we ask that you sing along with us. We're going to begin with an old church song that's been around the church for many, many years. And when you look at the condition of that after Jesus was finished dying on it, it wasn't a pretty sight. It was rugged. It was dirty. It was worn. And what this song helps us to appreciate is that's what our life is. Even though we came to Christ and we became one, we became new, we're still in our flesh. We still have to contend with our flesh. We still have to contend with the pain and sufferings of this life. But it's because we cling to the suffering of our Lord and we cling to Jesus Himself that we know that the suffering is all worth it. Like that old country song, I beg your pardon, I never promised you a rose garden. And you know what? Jesus never said our life would be easy. But He did say, I will never leave you, and I will never forsake you. And that's what this song is about. Clinging to the hope that we have in Him. And knowing that one day, we're not going to have to carry a cross anymore. One day, we will be wearing a crown. The old rugged cross.
On a hill far away, stood an old rugged cross. The emblem of suffering. And I love that old cross. Only here is the best for a world of lost and sinners must say. So I'll cherish the old rugged
Now, If what comes out of your mouth is ugly, is that a good sacrifice? What comes out of our mouth should be praises to God for what He is, what He was, and what He is still yet to be for us. That's the sacrifice. We praise Him. We praise Him when we're happy. We praise Him when we're sad. We praise Him when we got a little money in our pocket. We praise Him when we're flat broke. Everything we do should be to praising Him. And what the beauty of the Word says that God inhabits praise. How many of you need God in your life right now? You want Him in your life right now? Start praising Him. He inhabits praise. And this next song is a song we sang last week. It was an easy song for us to sing again, since our music director is not here, but we're going to praise with this song. Every praise. Not praising man. Not praising the government. We're praising Him with our praise. Every praise.
See?
praise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. We lift His name on high.
Oh,
If you're feeling tired, and you're feeling empty, feeling that the whole world is against you, you feel that you're chained and bound from having the life that you know that God wanted you to have. There's an addiction that has completely destroyed your life and your relationships. There's something there that you know you gotta let go of, but you can't. The truth is, you can't. You have to believe what He can do. They're here for a reason. We all have our own reason for being here. But Father, we know that as the Master, You're here to fulfill every individual need. There's many here, Father, that may come with an empty soul. But we pray, Father, that they will leave with a full soul. We pray, Father, that many will feel complete in a world that takes everything away from us. The enemy steals everything. He steals our possessions. He steals our joy. He steals our spirit. But Father, when we come into Your presence, fullness of joy, we leave complete. We're praying, Father, for that blessing to rest upon every soul here. What's been intended to hear through the various programs today, through the Word, we pray, Father, that the right people hear it at the right time and the right change will take place. You are a magnificent, wondrous, and beautiful God. There's not enough adjectives that we could use to describe who You are. But one thing that's resting on our hearts this morning, You are our God. We love You. We thank You. We honor You. And we pray for Your Holy Spirit to take charge and control, to teach us, to comfort us, to to inspire us all for your glory and for your praise. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
We will have transportation.
Father, stoops down, bends down, to intently listen to his child as his child speaks. That simple act conveys a powerful message. My child is important. I love this child. I want to look into my child's eyes and listen. This is actually a picture of our Heavenly Father to each of us. I looked at a different translation to get the idea of this. In Psalm 116, verse 2, it says that He inclines His ear to us. In the New Living Translation, it says He bends down and He listens. He bends down and He listens. Now, why does God the Father want to bend down and listen to anything we've got to say? Number one, He either does it because He cares for us and He wants to be close to us. Or maybe He does it because our voice is so weak, He makes it easier for us to listen to. For Him to listen to us. That's really a profound thought. That our God cares that much for you and I. He lowered Himself for us. And you know, the Son, when He was on earth, showed that character. Do you remember what He did to His disciples' feet? He crouched down and He washed their feet. Showing God's intent, concern, and care for you and I. Right now, God the Father is in heaven and He is bending down to hear what you have to say. He's concerned with what you have to say. In fact, in speaking of Christ in Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 through 8, it says, though He was God, did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, He gave up His divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When He appeared in human form, He humbled Himself in obedience to God and He died a criminal's death on a cross. Why did He do it? Because He cared for you. He's interested in you. He cares about what you have to say. God stooped down to us. The interesting thing is, you or me, we can't do it. We don't do it. We can't do it. We can't reach up to Him with our own wisdom and work. There's no way that we could raise ourselves up to be near Him. There's no way. We can't do it. But as God's children, we're utterly dependent on Him. Our faith in Him should be like that of that child. Now what we have on this communion table right now is the bread and the cup. And you know what this reminds us of? It reminds us of Jesus' body and blood given freely. He's offering us freedom. But He's not forcing it down our throats. He's giving it. He's offering it freely. Take life's water free. And when you do, you become free. It reminds us of the perfect God lowering Himself that he might forgive us and embrace us as his beloved children. I'm not putting anybody on the spot here. This is a rhetorical question. If you want to raise your hand, you can, but you don't have to. How many of you right now have something in your life you need to be forgiven for? Glory to God. You're not afraid to confess that. You just confessed it by raising your hand. Do you believe in the power of forgiveness of God? If you walk out here today and get hit by a car, do you believe and know that by what you're doing right now, God has the power to wipe your slate clean and give you a fresh start? And if you got hit by a car, you have nothing to worry about? If you believe that, and you know that there's something heavy on your heart, I'm going to do something I don't usually do. I'm going to give you an opportunity right now to take just a few moments of silence and pray and ask the Lord to forgive you. And then, as we begin to serve communion, you're doing so with a free heart. And your slate is clean. As you go outside those doors, just remember, my slate is clean. When the devil comes knocking this afternoon, you don't have any place here, devil. I'm clean. I'm free. I don't explain that a lot, but one of the reasons that we do communion here at the Bread of Life every Sunday is I know there's heaviness on many of your hearts. As a shepherd, as an under-shepherd of the great shepherd, my commission and my calling is to keep you in heaven to the best that I can under the power he gives me. And that's how we do it, by repentance, forgiveness, receiving that forgiveness, putting faith in the God who changed us and made us new. So we're going to take just a moment. You confess to, you don't confess it to me, you confess it to God. But he already knows that he wants you to confess it, because what you're doing, you're letting go of it when you confess it to him. And you're going to ask God, take it. Make me new again. And after a few moments, we're going to ask Brother Dennis and our brother Stan if they would begin to serve after we say a prayer. Let's say a prayer of confession. We're going to say a prayer. Hold on, please. We're going to say a prayer over the bread and the wine. Then we'll begin to serve. Hold it till the end and we'll all take together. Our Father in heaven, we lift up what represents the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. It represents in totality our relationship with you and Him. And as we do this in the Holy Spirit, we are communing with you, Father. We are in your body. We ask, Father, that you bless this ordinance that we are now doing. As sinners have repented, Father, we pray that we will all leave here with a determined mind to press forward in our walk with you. Jesus meant so much to us. We thank you for the body. We thank you for the blood. And we give you the glory for what you are doing in us. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Jesus had that awful crucifixion day experience. It began with the stripes he received on his back. Actually, the truth, it began with the crown of thorns that was placed on his head. Because as they pressed the crown of thorns on his head, blood began to drip. We might even go a little bit further than that. The night before, when he was praying in the garden, you remember what happened to his blood, to his sweat? He lost blood then. Then he lost blood in the crown of thorns. Then he was put out in the courtyards of Rome and received the lashes on his back. Blood came forth from his body. But then he was placed on a cross. Six-inch nails that probably weighed at least 5 to 6 pounds apiece were driven through his hands and feet. He was placed upright for almost 6 hours before he expired. Whatever blood he had left in his body came out when the Roman soldier took the sword and pierced his side to make sure he was dead. Every drop of his blood came out of his body. And he lost it all for us. It was because he loved us that he lost it all. He stooped down because he loves you. And he's still stooping down for us every day. That's why the word says, in all your ways acknowledge him and he will make your path straight. That's what we're doing right now, acknowledging him. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we partake of the body of Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we take of the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to sing one last song before Pastor Kathleen gives us a message for today. This is taken from Psalm 34. This was an interesting story. David was going to stand before his oppressors and his opposers. His enemies. He was a well-sought man that many people wanted to catch and to kill. And he got caught. But the Lord gave him wisdom in how to deal with it. The Lord didn't send an angel out of heaven to come and swoop him up and get him out. He gave him an idea. So what did David do when he stood before his opponent, the other king who was wanting to have him killed? David went in acting like a madman, acting crazy. And the king looked at the guards and said, "Why did you bring this madman in here? Get him out of here." God gave him wisdom. Has God ever given you wisdom on how to get out of something? Well, this Psalm 34, is a psalm of praise over David's deliverance. And we're going to sing it right now. Psalm 34. Taste and see. Gives us the fullness of spiritual life that we lacked before we were saved. In John 17:3, and this is eternal life, that they may know you, Father, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. The word everlasting emphasizes life without end, though it will not be completely fulfilled until our future body is redeemed. Romans 8:23 says, and not only they, but we also who have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves, groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. Now you know you've done that, haven't you? Especially in a really hard time. You just groan and say to God, I wish it was all over and you were here. I know I have many times with the stresses of life that come to us. And John 10:28 says, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. And what a blessing. Everlasting life must not be believed only as a future possession. We possess it at the time of salvation. Its presence can be seen in our actions. And so no murderer has eternal life.
eternal life, abiding in him. And 1 John 3:15 says, whoever hates his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. Except the believer, a repentant one. Love is the confirming evidence that we do have eternal life.
Yes.
1 John 3:14 says, we know that we have passed from death to life because we love the brethren. He who does not love his brother abides in death. Now let me tell you something. We're not all perfect. I can remember a time when someone at church even just annoyed the heck out of me. I didn't like being in the person's presence. I just flat out didn't like them. And I said, God, change my heart. Do something. I have to work with this person for your good, Lord. Do something and help me to love this person more. Well, I'll tell you what, God is so faithful. Without a doubt. When she died, I mourned her death. She had been such a blessing to me. So it can be done with God's help. The greatness of this spiritual reality causes us to vigorously proclaim the gospel to those who are still dead in trespasses and sins. In Ephesians 2:1 it says, and you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sins. So if he's made you alive and your trespasses and sins have left, you're going to be a new person. Trust God, you really are. You're going to be happier. You're going to have love where you used to have this life. And, you know, it happens to us all. We all have those times when we need God to help us to do the right thing, think the right thing, and be the right thing. Ephesians 2:1 says, I'm sorry, 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. So if you're a new person, easier than trying to change your life without Christ. It just doesn't work. Because he is the one who can change us. The term new creation refers to the spiritual transformation that occurs within the inner man when a person believes in Christ as his Savior. And God's word confirms everything that you want to know. To confirm means to fully establish a truth or a fact. The Bible should be used to confirm the truth in our own hearts. It confirms our salvation. Often Christians are troubled with doubts about their conversion experience. I know there's a lot of people who confide that in me. Did God really save them when they asked him to do so? Are they still saved today? These are questions people ask. A number of verses may be used to confirm our salvation. One of the strongest is Jesus' own words in the Gospel of John. John 5:24 says, most assuredly I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. You'll recognize the old man when he crops up, and that's when you need to call on God. God, change me. Make me different than what I used to be. Compare this with John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Love those words. In John 6:27, do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him. In John 6:35, and Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. In John 6:37, all that the Father gives me, Jesus, will come to me, Jesus. And the one who comes to me, I will by no means cast out. He will never cast you away. He will always help you to maintain your salvation. John 6:40, and this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life. You know me? Everlasting life. And I will raise him up at the last day. In John 10:27-29, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. I just love that. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. And Romans 8:1, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. God's word confirms the hand of God in all of life's bitter disappointments. There is no doubt that a most important verse of reassurance and comfort in the hour of great need is Romans 8:28. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. Amen. I only wish that I had stuck with my Bible closer when I lost my son in 1990. Then I would have known that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. God's word confirms our forgiveness when we sin, and sometimes believers carry unnecessary burden of guilt over past sins and failures. Even though these have been confessed, they have a difficult time believing God has truly forgiven and cleansed them. But time and again, the Bible assures us that all confessed sin is instantly and eternally forgiven. Now let me give you some confirmation of that. Psalms 32:5. I acknowledge my sin to you, and my iniquity I have not hidden. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. That's in Psalms. I'm sure that was something that David said to God. In Psalms 103:12, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. In Isaiah 38:17, indeed it was from my own place that I had great bitterness, but you have lovingly delivered my soul from the pit of corruption, for you have cast all my sins behind your back. That was Isaiah 38:17. I like that one too. And my favorite is the next one, Isaiah 1:18. Come now, and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Believe it. Receive it. And don't hang on to that memory of your last past sins, because God doesn't.
Amen.
Thank you.
Sometimes that's the hardest problem we have is letting go. We can let go of it's hard to sometimes let go of trespasses of others, forgive them. But I think for us it's even harder to let go of being upset with ourselves. Why did I do that? Why did I go back to that? You know what we do? We get into this mindset that we want to lock the door and lock everything out around us. But we don't know how to deal with it. There was a little story after Jesus had been crucified. For 40 days he kept coming back in the resurrection. Remember that? He would pop back in and pop out before he ascended to heaven. We read this the other night at our praise night, but it's appropriate today too. John chapter 20, verse 19. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, that's Sunday. This happened on Sunday. The doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace the view." Why did the disciples have the door locked? The fear that, why were they afraid of the Jews? What had the Jews just done to Jesus? They incited Rome to crucify Jesus, right? It was the chief priests and the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the scribes that incited Rome to get rid of Jesus. Jesus is now gone, so they think. So now they're in their houses with all the doors locked. Because they're afraid if the Jews know where we're at, if the religious leaders know where we're at, they're going to have Rome come after us. But while the door was locked, what did Jesus do? He showed up. He just appeared before them. And what were the first words out of his mouth? "Peace be unto you." And it was right after that that Thomas came up and looked at it, and he had to touch the holes. Right? That was the same time that all that happened. The question is your door locked? Are you afraid because of what you did? You have no relationship with God? Are you afraid of yourself? Are you afraid of other people? Why is your door locked? But guess what is happening right now? While in the presence of God and in the Holy Spirit, what's happening right now is Jesus is showing up and he's saying, "Peace be unto you. Peace 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 be unto you." He's looking at every one of you. Peace, 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 peace. He's letting you know it's okay. He's letting you know you don't have to be afraid. You thought I was gone? No, I'm here. I'm here right now. I'm in your situation. As we said in communion, I'm stooping down. I'm taking note of what you're going through. I'm here. That's what he's doing right now. Why does he do it? Because he loves us. There is no one in this room or anywhere in Sanford, there's nobody who's a lost cause. Completely. All things are possible with God. There are no impossibles in Sanford or in you. But what do you have to do? You do have to do something. You have to receive it. You have to accept it. And when Jesus gets a hold of you, you gotta let him govern the rest of your way. He's showing his hands to you right now. He's showing his feet to you right now. Pastor Kathleen just gave a message about everlasting life. Everlasting life starts now if you accept it. Did you know that? It starts now if you accept it. You have it now if you accept it. Now, she said nobody can snatch you out of his hand. That's true. The devil cannot make you do anything. The devil cannot snatch you out of his hand. But you know what you can do? You can leave his hand on your own free will. But if you stay in him and stick with him, nobody's going to take you away from him. And you will have everlasting life with him. The altar is open. Jesus is saying to each and every one of you, peace be unto you. It's okay. I will take your heavy heart and I will take the load off of it for you. I will take the regrets. I will take the guilt. I will take the shame. I will take it. I will destroy it. Just come unto me. If anybody wants to come to the altar is open. Hallelujah. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Thank you.
Thank you.
we're going to bless the food and do the benediction, and then we'll begin eating. We have a lot of variety today. We have a lot of variety. Did the watermelon get cut too?
Yeah.
Oh, God. I never ate this happy. Our Father in heaven, we thank you. We thank you so much for the food that's set before us. We thank you for the fellowship. We thank you for all the souls that came to your altar today. I pray that Jesus will cling, that they'll cling to Jesus as they leave here, and that Jesus will be the guide over their lives. Father, we thank you for the opportunity we had to praise and worship you. We thank you for the word, the spoken word, the reading of the word. We thank you for all that you have provided. It is your hand that is never short. We give you all glory, we give you all honor, we give you all praise. May the words of our mouth and the meditations of our heart be acceptable to you, O Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.